My name is Sophie. I suffered from fibromyalgia and extreme fatigue syndrome for about 24 years. Today I'm fully healthy. And now I would like to pass on everything I've learned about health and healing and more to support those who are still on a journey. And this is why I create this documentary series and podcast, The Puzzle of Healing. Hi everyone. Today is a very special episode. It is the first episode I'm talking to two ex-patients of the extreme fatigue syndrome. Both managed to recover and both are going to share their stories. I'm going to talk to Maylin and Toril, and we're going to talk about an organization called Recovery Norway, who made it their mission to share positive stories to give hope to those who still suffer. Enjoy. Hi Maylin, hi Toril. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you for having us.
Yes, thank you.
Can you just both introduce yourself a little bit and tell me, like, what was the illness you had and what are you doing in life? Just like a little introduction, who you are and what happened. And then we just dive in and talk a bit more about it in detail. Whoever wants to go first.
Toril, you want to start?
Okay. My name is Toril. I'm 51 years old. I work in HR with recruitment and onboarding with new employees in one of the directorates in Norway. I got ill with and I diagnosed with ME in 2008-2009. Then I got well, then a few years later I got sick again, and then I got well again, and now I've been well for like 3 years.
That's amazing. 3 years. Oh my God. Celebration. When do you have a month you're celebrating? Because like I have a month, like for me it is in November because that was very specifically when I got well. Do you have a celebration date?
Not really, no.
Oh!
Actually not. I never really got the date. I don't really know. I remember I did get well in the summer. No, I don't really think about that. That's funny. And I haven't thought about that.
But summer is definitely good time to kind of remember summer's that good. Life is good. How about you, Maylin? What's briefly your story?
Well, yes, I'm Maylin Geim. I'm 46. I'm married to an Englishman, and we have 4 kids, quite big now, from 13 up to 21. I was ill for 17 years with ME, and I do have a date for when I got well. It was Valentine's Day, actually, the 14th of February 2018, so that's just over 2.5 years ago.
Oh my God, that's amazing. I love that.
It's a nice day to get healed.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And also like the same year, like I got healthy, like I also got healed in 2018. So it's also very recent. Wow. And for everyone who doesn't know what ME is, like what is that illness? How is it defined? What's the full word for it?
Well, I don't really know much about the illness apart from what I experienced myself. I never Googled much and I didn't really want to know much about it. But for me, it was mostly fatigue. And I know for people that can be depression, it can be a lot of pain. It can be difficult to sleeping and different things. But for me, it was mostly fatigue. If I went for a walk, maybe I had to rest for, I don't know, 4 or 5 days afterwards. So, And then I had good days and bad days and good weeks maybe and bad weeks. So it varies a lot and you never know what your day is going to be like.
Yeah.
You don't know what you can expect your body to join in on or, yeah.
In a moment, I would really like to talk about like how you organized your days and your weeks because that's like really, really difficult. But first, Toril, how was it for you? And do you know the full name of ME? Because to be honest, I looked it up and I forgot the full name again. If we don't get to it, I'm going to blend it in later.
I don't. It's impossible to pronounce. I love the fact that we could call it ME because I have to admit it's a terribly long and hard to pronounce name. It's called. Is it? Maylin, can you help me?
It's also called CFS. That's another name for it. And I know those letters is called chronic fatigue syndrome.
Yeah.
Which is easier. I'm not sure about the ME. I can't remember.
Cool. Let's but just CFS skip the ME explanation.
Yeah. Chronic fatigue syndrome. Yeah.
How was it for you, Toril? What symptoms did you have?
Yeah, it was like having... It was like the end of a stomach flu combined with the real flu. It's like terribly tired, a body aches. I also have like the brain fog. I had trouble understanding what people were saying to me. Sounds were terribly. Everything sounded loud. I couldn't understand what someone was saying if there was a radio on, like there were two people talking at the same time. I had trouble with the memory, concentration, sleeping. I think that's about it.
Well, that's a lot.
For periods, I also had a lot of muscle ache. Mm-hmm. And also, Maylin said that if you did something, you had to like pay for it afterwards. You had to rest. You could be knocked out for days. So you had to kind of choose what you wanted to do because you knew you were going to be sick for a while afterwards.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I did exactly the same. I had to pick between school and seeing friends, and I mostly picked school for some reason. Maybe I should have picked more
sensible.
Than friends. Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
So how did it all start, like, for you two? When did it start? Was there an event that triggered it, or you think that is what triggered it, or how was the beginning?
My doctor, thinks it's kind of what triggered it was menopausis. Is that what you call it? The illness, an infection in the throat, and but that came kind of on top of a very rough period where a lot of things happened, kind of piled up on top of each other. A lot of stress. I had was an accident. I had an operation. There's a lot of things happening, and I had just gotten divorced. I had two kids, but they think that the illness is what kind of triggered everything. Because after that, I felt like I never got well again. I kind of was feeling sick all the time afterwards. So that's how it started, and I was in and out of sick leaves. At first, they thought just stress or like a burnout or things like this. And I went to a psychologist to check if I was depressed. So and then it started rolling. My doctors started checking everything, and they couldn't find anything. According to my doctor, I was well, but I was feeling more and more sick. So at the end, I didn't understand what people were saying to me. I was like, my head was not working. So I ended up in bed for weeks after that.
And that is when they then diagnosed it, or how long was it from that beginning to a diagnose?
I think it was about a year from I was starting to get sick till I got the diagnosis. And that was somehow it's you're glad to get a diagnosis because then you think, oh, I know what it is, but now I know what I can do. But this was that one diagnosis where they say you got this, you got ME, and there is absolutely nothing we can do. We don't know what it is, we don't know why you have it, we don't know how to get you well. Have a nice life. That's like
that's tough.
That was the way in. Yeah.
And how was it for you, Maylin? How was your start?
For me, it started with the four pregnancies I had. In all four of them, I got this. It's called like an extreme feeling of nausea, 24/7. I felt nauseous all the time, and I couldn't eat and I couldn't drink. And in two of the pregnancies, I had to be in the hospital for a few weeks to have liquid nutrition and to trying to start eating again. I normally love food, but not when I feel nauseous. So and after each pregnancy, I felt a little bit weaker. And I really never got quite back on my feet again properly. So after 5 years, and about after the third pregnancy, my doctor wanted to find out why I was so tired and fatigued all the time. So she sent me to the hospital, and they did a lot of tests, and they were all negative. And then they decided this is probably ME. So, and the doctor said to me the same message as Toril got. There's nothing to do about this. Just live as good as you can. Just try and have a good life. And that's what I decided to do. I decided, for me, it was good to focus on the good things in my life, like my children, my family, and not, I never Googled ME. I didn't want to know really about it. It wasn't that I was trying to say that I wasn't ill, but I had no interest in this ME disease. I really didn't. So I decided to just focus on what was good and just get on with my life, as there seemed to be nothing that could be done with it. So,
that's amazing. And you immediately jumped to that attitude. There was no dip of like despair and depression. You just immediately went, no, all right then.
Yeah.
That is impressive.
Yeah, I did. For me, that was the only way to live. Wow. To have a disease that you are told you can't do anything about this, then I think I'm just going to have to focus on what's good and what I can do. And of course, I had many, many times where I was on the settee, I was crying, I was feeling worthless because I wasn't really doing anything for society. I was trained as a nurse, I couldn't work. There was lots of things I couldn't do. So I had enough times where I was on the settee crying over that. But most of the time, I managed to focus on what was good in my life. And I think that made the years, the 17 years, happier than the alternative.
That is impressive. And 17 years is also like really, really long. Wow. And to kind of stick through to that, that's I didn't do such a good job. For me, it was really first like the absolute down, and it took me quite some time. And once I got out, it got better. And but yeah. How was it for you, Toril? Like how did you take it? What did you do after with that?
Yeah, I did the opposite of my Ellen. I'm a very eager Googler. I Googled and what I found was that the ME Association in Norway and all the information I could find was negative, that it's you have to be very careful. I read about people who's been sick for years, who got sicker and sicker, who couldn't even eat their food. They couldn't go to the bathroom by themselves. It's very, very, very negative and very scary. And then you could read about I read about the LP or lightning process, like you could take a 3-day course and then you'd be well. And the way the ME Association presented it, it sounded like a hoax or like nothing. It's like too miraculous to believe in. So I felt like I had these two opposites, and none of them were like an alternative for me. So I decided I got mad. I was like, I'm not gonna. This is not okay. I'm not gonna do this. And this was after a few weeks in bed and getting a little better and starting to be able to get out of my bed and starting to be aware of the room around me. I had two kids, and I was very decided about them not having the feeling that they have a very sick mom they have to be around. I was a single mom or divorced, so I didn't want them to know that I was sick, so I kind of faked well around wow. them when I could, and then they went to school, and my mom helped me out, and then I started reading like psychology, healing, the secret, the power of thoughts, everything, manifestation, all kinds of things, through that I found that I found kind of some common ground, and I found my way to get well again, because I discovered through these books, through exercises in these books, that through controlling or steering my thoughts, I could fill up with energy, or I could drain myself. I did some exercises where you could feel, you could just feel it in physically, and then I realized that I have the power to change the energy in my body, and combined with mindfulness, meditation, to get stress out of my body, because my body was, I was kind of like this, my head was spinning, there were thoughts all the time, combined with observing my thoughts, observing how I thought about myself, because I went through, I was angry at the disease, I was disappointed with myself for not coping with everything, for like breaking or being soft or disappointing, failing at life, you know, it's just like all these feelings, it was terrible. And so I was kind of hacking on or, you know, knocking myself on the head, or like being kind of cruel to myself, and I had to discover this and then start changing those thoughts and accept the situation and not blame myself for being in this situation, and this way I started changing the energy in my body.
Is there an exercise that's easy to share that you could give as a little tip, or like the first
yeah, my
thing,
biggest
the first
aha was,
easiest?
Yeah, it was one exercise was just sit and think about everything good in your life, everybody you love, everything you like. Summer vacation, popsicles, whatever, you know, just and then think about all those happy things, and then you were supposed to get up and jump.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of strange. And then you sit down again and think about all the wars in the world, people, children starving, you know, everything terrible in the world, and then get up and jump. And it was almost impossible. It was like, it was so, it sounds kind of silly almost, or naive or childish, but it worked. And it was two completely different. So what you focus on and what energy that gives you, it was so clear to me. So that half full, half empty glass, it does things to you. And then also I started understanding how your thoughts releases different kind of chemicals or hormones in your body.
Mm-hmm.
So it's science in this, you know, but you don't learn that. Learn that. But I find out and found out and started to use this, and made all the difference in the world to me.
Wow. And did you at some point talk to your children about it, or did you remain Romanian for a thing you deal with, and how old were your children at that point?
At this time, they were like 6 and 9, so they didn't really think about that I didn't go to work anymore, because mm-hmm. it started in the start, they thought I just had a cold or the flu or something, and then I got better. I was home a lot, staying on the couch a lot, but they loved it. Having a stay-home mom. So I think that they didn't realize I was sick then. And then I was, after 1 year later, I was back in work, actually. So I was just sick for 1 year that time. Mm-hmm. But I got sick again some years later. And then we obviously had to talk about it.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. And I mean, for you, Malin, it must have been really hard, because when it came after your children, after the birth, it means you also had to be a mom for a very little baby at that time, right? How did you manage that? Because like nobody has energy when there is a little baby in the house.
Well, all of our four babies were very calm babies. So that was very good.
Good.
And they slept a lot, both in the day and in the night. So that really helped. And then I have a husband who has been helping me so much all these years, and my parents as well. So everything I couldn't do, I would always do what I could, but everything I couldn't do, they would help me with. Mm-hmm. So, and often like I said I would make dinner today. So I started and I tried, and then in the middle of it, I had to go to bed. And then they would take over. And you know, when the kids got bigger, even they would take over when Aww. I had to go and rest. So yeah, they grew up with a mother who was very tired. But I think, you know, they said after I recovered, they've said that they didn't really think about the fact that I was ill. They knew I was tired and then I needed to rest a lot, but that was just life. They kind of grew up with me like that. I was like that always. So, and you know, I had some good days in between where we could go out for walks or do fun things. So it wasn't all bad. And I think for the kids as well, you know, growing up and seeing that there are people who live like this and who need help. And well, I think it can be a good experience. They learn to kind of help other people and kind of help take care of them, and that can be a good thing, I think.
Yeah, and I think what probably also helps is to just trust that that's what's going on, that what the person is saying, that that's what's really happening. Because like I don't know if you had any other experiences, but like what I experienced is that after a certain amount of time, people stop believing me that I have an illness. Because for me, it took 7 years to come to a diagnosis.
Yeah.
So within that 7 years, I experienced a lot of people talking behind my back that I just want attention, that I'm just pretending to be in pain. And I think that is also like really good thing for children to learn, that you don't put these things in question, that you just trust that's the experience.
That's right.
And I really wish doctors or like one doctor told me years later, if somebody experiences pain or is unwell, then it is important to tell that person that that's a real experience.
Yeah.
Despite
Definitely.
If there is a real, real cause you can find in the body. And I think that's something a lot of people don't really understand. But that would be so important, because I think we are all full of stress. And I think all of those illnesses have a lot to do with stress. And if
Definitely.
We would talk a bit more about what that actually means, I think we could all help each other a lot more. So how did your journeys continue? I mean, it sounded like you did a pretty awesome job in like how to tackle it, and how did it go from like you managed your life to you actually fine, completely fine, healthy, cured? Like what was that step? I mean, Toril, you said, was that really the mindfulness and the meditation that just like vanished at some point, or did you find something else? What was the thing that helped?
Yeah, what happened with me was that when I got well, I got back to work, and then I got on living my life, and I kind of forgot that I ever had the ME. You kind of just want to leave it behind, never think about it again. So I was well for about 4 years, and then I got another infection that lasted a very long time, and I think it triggered, you know, like the brain remembers things. And it triggered all the symptoms to come back because this infection was so similar to the one I had before. And a lot of the symptoms came back and it really scared me. And I started getting worried that I would get sick again. And I just got worse and worse. And when I think about it afterwards, it's kind of strange how I at that time didn't remember, or maybe didn't have like the energy to think about what I did the last time, because I was sick for a year again. Before I kind of had, I took like, made like a decision that because I kind of accepted that this time I have like real ME. I got really sick this time. The last one was just like, I don't know. So I joined the ME Association and the ME forums online, and I got really pulled down. It was a very negative time. It's very strange to think about now afterwards how I could kind of let that happen. But I was like pulled down again, and I was really sick again for a year before I kind of, I don't know, I kind of woke up. I got enough because it was so much negative energy in everything that had to do with this illness. So I kind of had like a, I think I just got mad again or something. Just like, I have to do this again. And then I kind of, you know, you roll up your sleeves and you kind of find the old books and your notes. And I did the same thing again. But this time I think I went a bit deeper, not just changing the energy. I also took a closer look at how I kind of treated myself, how I thought about myself. My integrity, my values, I kind of took a full account of everything, and I did some big changes in my life. I did the same thing. I did use the same techniques, but I did a big house cleaning inside when it comes to live genuine and be the real me, kind of, not just who I thought I was supposed to be or should be or expected to be. So this was a very important shift for me, and I haven't looked back. I have worked full time. I work out. I have a whole new great life now, and that's good.
And what was it about those, the contact with those groups or this association, that was so downpulling for you?
The focus was very negative. And also I felt very unpowered. Like I said, I felt very empowered when I realized I could do this change. And these groups unpowered me, or I felt powerless. I felt like I was the disease. I was this diagnosis. I felt all the focus was on talking about symptoms, illness, all the negativity, the hopelessness, how everybody else thought about you, that you weren't understood. I think it took a lot of energy away, and also most of all, I think made me feel powerless. I had no power over my situation, and I think that's the main, the most important thing that happened to me, I think, is that I got back the power over my own life.
That's brilliant. So we just talked about how important the power, the empowerment is. How was that for you, Mayalyn? Was that one of the things that was important for you that you felt empowered, that you felt like you have a chance to fix this? And what was it for you that healed it? Because it took 17 years to find the solution. What was it?
Yeah, definitely. Those 17 years, I believed there was nothing that could make me better. So I didn't look for any solutions. Maybe I should have, but I didn't. I was happy living my life, kind of. So, but then I met a mother of a teenage girl who told me once that her daughter, I think she was 16, had had ME and had been sent to this psychiatrist who had a PhD in this CFS ME disease. And she got so much better, nearly fully recovered. And she said, you can go there too and get better. And I really felt strongly when she told me this, that this was for me. I was meant to do this. So the next morning I contacted my own daughter, doctor, and it took a few months. It took about from July to February. But then I got to join this doctor, Bjarte Stubhaug, in his 4-day treatment program. And that was really an eye opener for me. I was 44 years old. I was trained as a nurse many years ago, but I had no idea what was going on in my body, why I had the symptoms I had, why I felt so tired all the time, why I rested and rested and I just got worse. I never got better from resting. I just kept getting worse. So I didn't understand anything, and that was really frustrating. Mm. And I don't think that was making me any better, all that frustration. So in this 4-day program, we had a lot of teaching. He took us through the whole body, what's going on in the body, why do we get all these symptoms? And all of a sudden I understood what was happening. And we had good education. We had mindfulness sessions that were really, really good. We had cognitive group therapy, calm, physical activity, like going for walks and things like that.
That all in 4 days?
In 4 days. Wow. It was quite intense, but for me that was a good thing. And a lot was going on inside me those days, really. It was like pulling a plug out. I don't know, all this stuff I had dammed up inside. So on the third day, I just recovered within a few minutes.
Wow.
Mm.
And that program is specifically for patients with ME, or what was that?
It's for patients with CFS ME and other, it can be other causes as well for the fatigue, but it's mostly for fatigue and for chronic pain as well. Mm. Yeah.
And I remember that you said before we started recording this episode that you didn't expect from this to actually get healthy. So no. what did you think that happened, and how was that feeling when you realized it's gone? How was that?
Well, I didn't expect to recover fully, because Dr. Stubhaug had said to me that this 4-day program was about not necessarily recovering fully, but to master the disease, kind of, and to live better and to live broader, wider, and to be able to say yes to more of the things you want to do. So that is what I was hoping for. But then all of a sudden, noticing that my symptoms disappeared and they didn't come back, it was a shock. It was a big shock. And I didn't expect it. And I was high up and low down every 2 minutes. So I was very, very happy. And I was very scared as well, because I didn't know what this new life would take me. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. Suddenly you're not a patient anymore. Suddenly you're just
That's right.
You.
Yeah.
Are you,
That's
how is it
right.
now? 1.5, almost 2 years later. Do you still have that fear, or did you change your coping mechanisms? Like, how was this time after it
Well,
all
it's
gone?
nearly it's just over 2.5 years now. I can still get scared. I really do. For me, I hadn't been a grown up much, not having ME. Most of the people my age, they have so much experience. They have worked for years and years, and they have done all these parenting things in schools and organizations and everything. And I haven't done any of that, hardly. So I felt like, I was 44 and I felt like a 20-year-old. And there were so many things. The first morning I woke up after I recovered, I could all of a sudden I could see how much fear had stopped me from doing what I wanted to do, because in the end, my life was nearly completely run by fear, and I was mostly afraid of being away from the settee or my house when I got ill. So I in the end I just said no to mostly anything because I was too afraid of being somewhere and not feeling well. So the morning after I recovered, I said to myself, from now on, you're not allowed to say no to things you want to do because of fear.
That's a good
And that was
agreement
a
with yourself.
decision, yeah, that was a decision I made, because now I thought, I don't have the disease anymore. I'm free to live and I'm going to live. But that means that everything that I've had to do for the first times has caused so much fear before I did them. So much that I would get headaches and I would feel nauseous and I would think that this is crazy. You're not going to survive this. Like, I started kayaking, and I would be terrified on the way to the sea, where I was going to meet my friends. But then I noticed the second I started doing what I wanted to do, like the second I got down in my kayak, the fear disappeared. And that taught me that, okay, fear is trying to stop me from doing what I want to do, but if I do it anyway, it would disappear, the fear. And then I also noticed that if I did repetitions of what I was afraid of, it would get easier every time. So I decided to do everything that I wanted to do and just repeat them, and then they started getting easier. But having been ill for as much as 17 years, there's still a lot of things that I haven't done for the first time. So I'm still battling that fear. I really am.
That's amazing. Oh, that makes me super happy to hear. How was it for you, Torel? Like, did you get better and it was okay, or did you have anything you had to cope with afterwards?
No, I think I was, but I think I was expecting to get well, kind of. So it wasn't a surprise to me, like it was for my healing. Because I kind of decided to get well, and I would have been extremely disappointed, of course, if it hadn't worked or something. But no, I just very proud and very happy, and I think you appreciate the things you can do so much more because, like Maya says, you're not afraid anymore. The fear is fear of getting sick, or you're not going to be able to complete, or it's gone. So you feel very free. That's a very good word. But I think everybody who's been sick for a long time, I think it would be very normal to be kind of, because big changes are always scary, and to get well, if you kind of go out and say I'm well, then people will start expecting things from you, and then maybe you'll be afraid to kind of fail them or not. So you kind of want to keep it to yourself for a while, I think. And I also had physically I was in a, not in a good shape. So you have to start like training yourself. It's not like, yeah, you get well, but you're not well.
Yeah.
You're not, the whole body isn't well, so you have to kind of like train yourself, start walking and start doing things because you've been laying out flat for a long time. So you have to get used to it.
Yeah. I found myself over preparing because like one thing that kept me going was like way too many supplements, food supplements. And so I noticed when I would go out, I would have tons of them with me, even though I wouldn't even need them anymore. But I just like, I was so terrified that I would still need them, that I had made sure I'm sleeping definitely enough before I went out to do something. And then I had like snacks with me in case like I really need them, and then the supplements. And I kind of did that for quite a while until I realized this is ridiculous. Like, I'm good. I don't need that anymore. And like, for me, the unlearning of all these systems that were in place to get me through a day, that was a good half year work for me as well.
But yeah, unlearning, yeah. That's a good word. Yeah, you have to do a lot of unlearning.
Yeah.
So it's like unlearn to be sick, kind of. Yeah,
yeah.
Because it's on the auto
exactly.
pilot.
And then
of.
The
yeah.
autopilot switches to, oh my God, I'm healthy and now I can discover. At
yeah.
least that's how it felt
yeah.
for me. That is, oh my God, I love your stories. There's so much power in them and so much inspiration. And I really love how you just managed to get this positive attitude, and especially 17 years to kick through with that attitude and just like, totally, you just say, you just expect that you get better. I think that is amazing. So how did you get in touch with Recovery Norway? Like, what is Recovery Norway? Because that is how I got in touch with both of you. So I would love to talk a little bit about that project. What is it? What is Recovery Norway?
So Recovery Norway is an organization that was started in 2017 by a doctor called Henrik Vogt. And it expanded as an international network in 2019. Recovery Norway consists of people who have an ME CFS disease, who have recovered from this. And their family members can join as well as our members. And our mission is to create understanding of this health problem, and also to give a justified hope that it is possible to recover from this disease. And for me, it was the year after I had recovered. My story was published in three national newspapers, and then Henrik got in touch with me asking if I wanted to become a member, and I really did.
That's amazing. How about you, Toril? How did you get in touch with Recovery Norway?
I found them on Facebook, and I commented on a story and how good it was to... that it was important to give people hope, and that I had experienced something similar. And then Henrik, the doctor who started Recovery Norway, contacted me and asked if I would like to become a member and if I wanted to share my story.
And what is it the organization is doing? So one thing I get is like it shares the positive stories. What else is the organization doing? Or is that mainly what it is, sharing, spreading the word, basically?
That is partly what we do, and it's a very important part of it. We we share stories of former ME patients who have recovered. We have about 80 stories now, both a Norwegian, yeah, it's fantastic, both a Norwegian website and also an English one. And actually in 2019, we had 100,000 hits and 50,000 unique readers on our website, and that I think is fantastic.
That is fantastic.
And I hear that people give us feedback that it gives them hope, which is exactly what we want to do. But we also, our members, we participate in meetings and in conferences where we share our stories and we teach about what this is and how we recovered. So we've been speaking to both national and international health leaders and to doctors. And I'm also now, I've been invited to the hospital in my nearest town, Stavanger, where I teach or tell my story to patients who still suffer from ME.
Wow.
So that's, I do that once a month. So that's very exciting. So we try and spread our stories and spread information where we can, where we are invited.
That is amazing. That is so brilliant. I just yesterday recommended Recovery Norway to someone on Facebook, actually, because I thought that it's such a brilliant website with so much positive input and it could be so good.
Yeah. That's very
amazing.
Good.
Before we wrap up this episode, is there anything that we haven't talked about, anything you want to share, or maybe something like something you want to say to someone who is still suffering or someone who is supporting anyone, anything along the lines of that, anything you want to say?
First of all, I think it's important to say that I don't remember if you said it, Maylin, but to the members in Recovery Norway, the way we got well, it's some different ways, but they were all through the change of thoughts or cognitive work. It's not any pills, medicine, food, drink, anything like that. I think that's important to us, I think. Isn't that right, Maylin, to get that through?
I agree, definitely. And this is not about, you know, wishful thinking to believe yourself healthy, or if you wish it hard enough, then it might happen. But this really is how our body is made. You know, in the old days, doctors would say there's this broken knee, and this in room four, like in the hospital. But we were trained as nurses to see the whole patient. And even if you have a broken knee, you may be full of fear that is really, you know, keeping you from not being well, getting well. So the thing is that the physical and the psychological is just so, it just is so connected. You can't separate one from the other. You can think yourself, if you're really stressed, you can get a tummy ache, or if you have a tummy ache, you can get really stressed or really fearful, and this kind of stresses the whole system in us. So just knowing that our bodies and our thoughts are very connected, and you know, it's not about wishful thinking, but still there's so much power in our thoughts, you know, in to use in the healing process, I think. And that is for everyone. It's not just for the believers or strong in faith. It really can be for everyone, I think.
Yeah, I think that's important too, and I think the medicine or the medical profession today is very limited to the school medicine and only focusing on the broken knee, like you say, and it doesn't really take in the connection between the brain and how the whole brain and the hormones and the science and how this affects and how this connects and how this whole thing works. I think that's so important, and I think so many more people should know this, because when you understand this, then you realize what's happening. Like Maya said, suddenly you realize what's happening with your body, because and when you understand that, it's so much easier to understand how you can change and how you can get better. Or I just think that's, I don't know why this is like a missing link. And I don't know why there's so little focus on this and so a little knowledge of this. And I just really think it's so important to let people know, and to the people can understand, so they realize that they can choose a different way of thinking.
Yeah,
and how important it is.
Absolutely. And even if it's a more severe illness where you do need the school medicine, I think that power of thinking and the positivity and your own power of healing is like even there, as you said, the missing link. It would be really good
because the fear and the worrying is so bad for you.
Definitely. Thank you so much for this wonderful conversation. I think there is a lot of really, really positive stuff in there people can take away from it. And thank you so much for your work you're doing with Recovery Norway as well. That's really brilliant.
You're very welcome, and thank you so much.